So we're here in Thessaloniki at the Nanotechnology Conference, and who are you?
I'm Yannis Missirlis, from University of Patras in Western Greece, yes. And it is my, I think, 15th time I'm here.
So this is the, this is your, this is your, what's called, what you do?
Well, not all I'm doing is this one, but I like the organizer from the beginning. I helped organizing the Nanomedicine part of it, and many important people have been invited and come through the years here, and I'm proud for that.
But I mean the field. This is
the field,
what you do.
The field is, yes, is what I'm doing. I'm going more into philosophical aspects of it, but that's what I'm doing.
Philosophical aspects of nanotechnology.
Of nanotechnology, nanomedicine, biology, so, life.
So what's the latest philosophy about nanomedicine and all this stuff?
It is that people use the reductionist approach to understand bits of pieces of biology, to translate that to medicine, and they forget the totality of things. So there is a new way of coming back to the totality of things, and in terms of a human being means the whole life of somebody, and that is that we need not only to go deeply reductionist wise into studying molecular interactions, but also go back with what is called now systems biology, to go from bottom up to understand the interconnectivity of health and diseases in a body.
Because is it true that the only way to do nanotechnology is to reduce and simplify things to like
to
very
isolate.
Simple, otherwise you can't do nanotechnology, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, there are, you can have too many isolative paths. You can see interactions. Nanotechnology is a technology. I'm talking about the basic mechanisms that can be used for technological production, if that's what you mean, because nanotechnology has also nanosciences in that. And nanoscience in that sense is trying to understand at the nano level how biology works.
But if you understand at the nano level how biology works, is it the same as how biology works?
No.
Because it's much more complicated, right?
It is much more complicated. This is what I'm trying to say. You have to go now from the bottom upwards to integrate. And that is not easy because there are what are called emergent properties. So 1 + 1 doesn't necessarily make 2 in this sense.
So, I mean, it would be 1 + 1 + 1 by billions of different ones, right? It's like very...
True.
A body is very complicated, right?
True.
But so how, what can we do?
Well, we try to understand ourselves. We try to understand how it works. And it was necessary to go at the nano level so that we have the basics. Now the big task is to try to understand how this integrates. It's like the genomic, you know, the human genome, when it was discovered, people thought, whoa, great, now we can understand all diseases. But genes are not alone, they collaborate. They fight with each other. They collaborate and fight. So it is a complicated thing that the next tens of generations of scientists, I hope, when time comes for them, that they will add something to that.
So we can see the whole genome, but we don't know what it does, each part of it, or do we?
Well, there are things that we know, or we think we know, and things that we surmise. So it's not very clear, because I'm pushing now the idea of what I'm calling mechanoepigenetics. So the genome is there, genetics is there, but the environmental impact on how genes are expressed themselves, this is the epigenome of everybody. And now it is the bacteria that we have we have more genes in our body coming from bacteria than from somatic cells. So this becomes much more complicated than the human genome. And then there is mechanics, because we live in gravity on Earth, so there is always a mechanical element that. This is what I'm calling mechanoepigenetics. And we are still in its infancy in understanding that.
Because all the molecules are constantly moving and affected.
Yes, yes.
By gravity and stuff.
By gravity, by electricity, by magnetism, by other molecules around them. It's a very, very dynamic and sometimes chaotic. And there are wars and fights and all the things that you can imagine.
And maybe but some forces we don't even know yet.
Well, true. Not that we don't know those forces, we don't know how they exert their influence on particular molecules at the time of deciding whether to be healthy or diseased.
So is there any chance we might just have a formula for the body, or that's not going to happen? Like just a like some kind of formula and to understand everything in the body?
No.
Or in general?
No.
There's like too many different things.
There is such a... Well, there is order out of chaos. But in order to find that order of chaos, we have to understand the basic movements of this chaotic cloud. So information is too much there, very fast. Mechanics is also very fast. You can touch something and then the response is far away, and we don't know all the different routes that this signal gets. So that's why we're here. We play with that. We try to understand. We have students who try to go it a little bit further. Sometimes it goes further back. But then overall, I'm, how to say, I believe that sooner or later, which means in the next few thousands of years, we might understand a little bit more who we are.
So how about in those last 15 years? Have you seen, I'm a little bit joking, but have you seen progress?
What is progress? Yesterday I gave a talk about the definition between development and progress. Is scientific reports always progressive? Do they move in the right direction, the knowledge, or sometimes the tides follow a certain paradigm and then lead many scientists into the wrong direction? It has happened. So we have to philosophize. That's why I put in the beginning of our talk the word philosophy. We have to reflect. We have to sit back from time to time and see, are we going in the right direction in uncovering the so-called mysteries of life?
So do we have examples of which times the science has gone the wrong direction?
Well, there is a very nice, current debate that started about 50 years ago. The action potential, that is how information in the neural system moves. Everybody now, not everybody, I mean the majority, the current, opinion of the scientific community is that this is an electrical event. But a Japanese guy about 50 years ago, working at NIH in Washington, D.C., and now being revived by a guy from Niels Bohr laboratory in Copenhagen, in Denmark, says, no, this is not right. This information is a mechanical event accompanied by the electrical one. And they claim, he and his team and some other people now get on board, that at the time that Huxon and Huxley got their Nobel Prize for this electrical event, the means, the technological means of measuring, identifying and measuring the mechanical event didn't exist. That was in the 60s. Now that we have nanotechnological tools to measure these changes, the paradigm shift might be tremendous. And of course, there are a few scientists that try to combine the two.
So we have tools to measure what happens in the brain, is that what
yes,
you said?
Yes.
Is it just like a big MRI or what's it called?
No. These are nanotools. For example, a neuron, when information passes through, can change its diameter by 5 to 7 nanometers.
When what passes through?
The information, the current. You know, information is, so far we think it's current. These people say it's not current, it's acoustic waves. And the current, which is ionic, follows that. Now, who is right? I don't know, I'm not an expert in there, but it's fascinating that there are arguments now who come out because some parameters are measured by technologies that can measure things before we couldn't see. Or, for example, measuring temperature. When this information passes down an axon of a neuron, the change in temperature is 1/1,000,000th of a degree. So now they can measure this. And there are other details that maybe are not of interest here.
So day after tomorrow is elections here, but I don't want to talk about politics, but shouldn't the scientific community kind of know what needs more funding? And then the money should just come there, and does it help if there's more money?
That's politics. I love politics. I'm Greek, you know. So all scientists are not the same. All politicians are not the same. We live in a capitalistic world. There are interests, and some of these interests are fighting, or even funding goes to specific directions. For example, why IT technologies are going so fast in the last 30 years, at least in Europe? It is because European Union put a mark there, and 30 to 35% of all funding goes there. So if you give funding there, you will get more data. If you give funding to, say, orphan drugs, you might develop new drugs. So it is, how to say, that's a political decision. Science and politics are interconnected. It can't be otherwise.
But do you think faster developments can happen with more funding? How does it work? How do we get to more results quicker?
The thing is not to get results quicker. The thing is to get the right results quicker. So that is how you design a call for action. How you design what are the strategic areas to do research. Now, this is a political question. If you go to armaments, you know, there are money, that funding that we don't even dream of in the basic sciences. And basic science have been neglected by all big powers, all big funding agencies, because the demand is for products.
So what products do you hope to see in the near future?
Products?
What do you want to see humanity achieve in the near future?
Okay. There are two parallel ways. In the area of medicine and biology, I think the effort will be to save more lives. But to save more lives means to have less diseases. Now, disease is a polyparametric system. Is not, disease is related to the economic conditions of living. In the environmental, I was reading an article that was very interesting in Scientific American, the last issue, that the poor people in New York City live in a more polluted environment than the richer ones, although the richer ones produce more of the pollutants. So you can see that what I want to see is that humanity improves the livestock of all of its citizens, and all efforts is to prevent first and then cure in the most helping way. At the same time, there is another road to try to understand the basic workings of life, and that would help develop research and develop better treatments, better pharmaceuticals, electroceuticals, whatever devices and chemicals, mainly biological, and you know, you have to believe in evolution, or to not to believe, to abide by evolution. Otherwise, you cannot understand how chemistry came into our lives. You see, big pharma produces drugs. How they produce them? How they decide which one to invest on? How many cancer, anti-cancer drugs have been developed in the last 20 years? One has to do some meta-analysis to see, independently though, independently, that's a very important issue. Because sometimes scientists are also corrupted. So it's a world that is complex. Scientists and science in general, we are part of this world. We try to rationalize more, and hopefully these things will find their way into the minds of those who decide. Eventually it's not the people, but the politicians.
Is there any chance we might have a cure for cancer and arthritis and diabetes in the next 5 to 10 years?
No.
You don't think so?
No, I don't think so, because these are systemic diseases. When you say cancer, even a specific cancer, pancreatic cancer, it's a very complex set of conditions. You think you destroy something, you remember, then something else arises. Same thing, arthritis. I mean, this is the immunological system of the body that defends sometimes is coerced by cancer, instead of fighting the cancerous cells, to be an accomplice of the cancerous cells. So it's a fight. It has traitors. It has all kinds of die or live. You know, so in order to see sooner than later solutions of big debilitating diseases, we have to understand the totality of mechanisms that bring these diseases into humans.
Isn't it a little bit negative, or don't you hope to be wrong, maybe? That maybe something suddenly...
No, I think I'm more realistic, because you know, to hope only without doing something for that, it's meaningless to me.
All right, so thanks a lot. I'm looking forward to the next conference.
Okay.
Okay, thanks.
I'll be here, hopefully. Hope to see you again.